Welcome back to the third part of orbital imaging. In the previous parts, we saw the bony and the compartmental anatomy of the orbit as well as the globe pathologies. Today, we are going to discuss about the optic nerve and optic nerve sheath pathologies. So, optic nerve is a second cranial nerve and it's special because it's actually the extension of the brain, and hence all the abnormalities, all the diseases seen in the brain are also seen to involve the optic nerve. I have divided the optic nerve pathologies into categories. So, we come to the congenital category, which includes aplasia and hypoplasia. The demyelination or the inflammatory process includes optic neuritis, multiple sclerosis, ADEM, neuromyelitis optica, NT-MOG associated demyelination. Tumors include optic glioma and optic meningioma. And the miscellaneous pathologies include increased intracranial pressure and secondary atrophy because of various causes. So, coming to the congenital category, here we see T2 axial and T2 coronal weighted images where there is complete absence of the globe, that is anophthalmia, associated with absence of both the optic nerves and the optic chiasm. This is a very rare pathology. So, this is anophthalmia with aplasia of optic nerve and optic chiasm. This is a 7-year-old girl who had gradual loss of vision. So what do we see here? We see very thin optic nerves associated with dilated or prominent subarachnoid space in the optic nerve sheath. Also note the optic chiasm is very thin and there is absence of septum pellucidum. So this is septo-optic dysplasia. Septo-optic dysplasia is also called as de Moisseur syndrome. It is associated with pituitary and hypothalamic dysfunction or may be associated with schizencephaly and polymicrogyria. This is a 23-year-old male who had sudden onset of bilateral vision loss, and what do we see here? We see flare and T2 hyperintense signal involving both the optic nerves, almost entire extent of the intraorbital part of the optic nerve. This is a sagittal weighted image which is showing the same, that is complete involvement of the optic nerve. So this is optic neuritis. In optic neuritis, we see the nerve is swollen and there is effacement of the subarachnoid space in the optic nerve sheath. Now, optic neuritis can be idiopathic, like in the last case which I showed you in 50% of the cases, or it can be associated with various other demyelinating syndromes, like in this case. So, in this case, the patient with optic neuritis, remember here the optic, only the anterior part of the intraorbital segment of optic nerve is involved, rest is paired. And also this patient had multiple brain lesions, that is multiple plaque-like lesions in the periventricular white matter which are perpendicular to the lateral ventricles. There are multiple juxtacortical lesions also. So this is classic multiple sclerosis. Now, again, this is another case, 26-year-old female who had bilateral optic neuritis and had multiple plaques in the brain as well as in the spinal cord. So, this is classically called as Dawson's finger because the plaques are perpendicular to the lateral ventricle and they also involve the corpus callosum. Also we see plaques in the brainstem as well as the plaques are seen in the spinal cord. Remember, the spinal cord plaques are short plaques and usually they involve the lateral or the posterior funiculus. So always sagittal flare images are recommended in these patients, and also screening of spinal cord to rule out spinal cord involvement. Contrast is must to see the disease activity. This is a 35-year-old male who had acute onset of tingling numbness in the left upper limb with blurring of the vision. So this is the post contrast axial image where we see enhancement of the intra orbital as well as intra canalicular segment of the right optic nerve, along with a long segment of demyelination involving the cervical cord. The cord in the cord here is swollen and it shows patchy enhancement. So this is neuromyelitis optica, and the patient was seropositive for anti-aquaporin 4 IgG antibody. This autoantibody has a sensitivity of 73% and specificity of 91% for neuromyelitis optica. Though this was a male patient, remember neuromyelitis optica is more common in females than in males. This is an 8-year-old girl who woke up in the morning with acute onset of loss of vision. So what do we see here? We have flare axial image where we see multiple cortical, juxtacortical, deep white matter lesions which are very large, and also there is enhancement of the optic chiasm. So there is optic neuritis associated with these brain lesions. So this is acute disseminated encephalomyelitis or ADEM. The patient had history of fever and vaccination few days back, hence this history is extremely important. So how do we differentiate optic neuritis in multiple sclerosis, NMO and anti-MOG antibody? So female preponderance is present in multiple sclerosis and NMO. Remember, NMO and anti-MOG antibodies, optic neuritis is almost similar with few differences which I'll mention. So when you have bilateral involvement and recurrent optic neuritis, it's usually NMO or anti-MOG antibody. Rapid recovery is rare with NMO. However, with anti-MOG antibody, it is frequent. Now on imaging, what do we see? We see only short segment of optic nerve involvement in multiple sclerosis as compared to NMO and anti-MOG antibody, where long segment is involved along with involvement of the chiasm, especially with NMO. Perineural enhancement is present with anti-MOG antibody. And on brain MRI, how do we differentiate lesions? Multiple sclerosis, as I mentioned before, we have Dawson's finger, juxtacortical lesions, lesions in posterior fossa, and the spinal cord usually short segment with wedge shaped lesions, whereas NMO are usually hemispheric white matter lesions. Periependymal lesions are most common around the hypothalamus and around the periaqueductal third ventricle as well as fourth ventricle. In the cord, usually they have longitudinally extensive transverse myelitis, that is a long segment is involved. However, cervical and dorsal cord are more commonly involved with NMO. Anti-MOG antibody usually will have multifocal brain lesions, involvement of deep gray matter, diffuse brainstem involvement, and the cord involvement is usually longitudinally extensive transverse myelitis, but however it involves mainly the conus medullaris. Remember, prognosis is poor for NMO, however better for MS and anti-MOG antibody. Actually, anti-MOG antibody has the best response compared to other two. Okay, so this is a 18-year-old boy who had known SLE, who came with intense headache and blurring of the left eye, left vision. So again, we see here there is abnormal signal involving the optic chiasm on both the sides. However, the left side is swollen and it shows enhancement. So this is SLE associated optic neuropathy. Now coming to the tumors of optic nerve, we have optic nerve glioma. It's the most common primary tumor of the optic nerve, and it is mainly seen in the children associated with NF1. Now what do we see on imaging? We see that the optic nerve is expanded and it is not seen separately from the tumor. So usually the tumor is of low grade, that is pilocytic in children, and it is of aggressive form in the adults, that is grade 3 and grade 4. Sometimes cystic component may be present in this tumor. Usually, in NF1 patients, the behavior is benign and it can spontaneously regress. So, imaging pearls, as I mentioned, fusiform or tubular enlargement of the optic nerve with the nerve not seen separately, associated with kinking of the nerve, and there can be ectasia of the optic sheath. This is another child who has bilateral optic nerve glioma. So notice fusiform enlargement of both the optic nerves and also of the optic chiasm. So this is the optic chiasm. The stalk is deviated to the left side and the lesion is showing heterogeneous enhancement. So this is bilateral optic nerve gliomas in NF patients. Remember, prognosis in NF1 patient is better compared to non-NF1 patient, and it is known that these tumors can spontaneously regress. If they are involving only the optic nerve, the prognosis is much better compared to the involvement of the optic chiasm. This is a 53-year-old female with loss of vision since 10 days. So here we see a eccentric soft tissue thickening involving the periphery of the optic nerve, mainly located along the medial, superior and the inferior aspect. And this is the optic nerve which is seen separately. So this is optic nerve sheath meningioma. It's a benign tumor which is arising from the meningoepithelial cells of the arachnoid situated along the optic nerve sheath, mainly seen in middle-aged women and in children with NF2. So what do we see here? We see peripherally enhancing tumor which is hyper intense, and the centrally hypo intense is the optic nerve. So this is classically called as tram tract sign. So this allows differentiating meningioma from optic nerve glioma. This is another case which shows similarly a peripherally enhancing area in the left optic nerve. So this is actually enhancement of the optic nerve sheath. So this is called perineuritis. This is an inflammatory process. Now coming to the tram tract sign differential diagnosis. So what is tram tract sign? Basically, there is enhancement of optic nerve sheath surrounding the unenhanced optic nerve, and on coronal images it will have donut appearance. It is seen in optic nerve sheath meningiomas, sarcoidosis, metastasis, pseudotumor, leukemia or lymphoma. Now this is another case where we have the axial sections of the orbit which show dilatation of the CSF in the optic nerve sheath along with tortuosity of the optic nerves. So the tortuosity is better demonstrated on the sagittal images, and also on venography we see compression and decreased flow in the dural sinuses, especially in the transverse and the sigmoid sinus. So basically this is benign intracranial hypotension commonly seen in middle-aged females associated with sudden onset of vision loss, and most important we see papal edema on fundoscopy, and on MR there will be flattening of the posterior sclera with protrusion of the optic nerve head into the globe, which I will show in the next image. So this is actually papal edema on MRI, where you have flattening of the posterior sclera along with protrusion of optic nerve head into the globe. So this is papal edema. It will be seen as pale disc on fundoscopy. Okay, coming to ischemic optic neuritis. Ischemic optic neuritis is an acute condition, and it can be anterior ischemic optic neuritis or posterior ischemic optic neuritis. Now anteriorly, when ischemia or infarction is involving only the optic disc, so diagnosis is usually made by the history. The patients will present with acute painless monocular vision loss, and also diagnosis is with fundoscopy. There is no role for MRI in acute in anterior ischemic optic neuropathy, whereas in posterior ischemic optic neuropathy mainly involves the optic nerve and the optic chiasm, and color vision is the presenting symptom. So this was the case, 45-year-old female with sudden loss of vision on the right side after cholecystectomy surgery 4 days back. Now, so here we see restricted diffusion in the entire intraorbital segment of the optic nerve. And on flare images, there is hyperintense signal. So there is definitely optic neuritis. So this is a case of ischemic optic neuropathy. Usually the posterior type is seen in perioperative period following cardiac surgery, spine surgery, and major abdominal surgeries. It is associated with hypertension, diabetes mellitus, myocardial infarction, and hypercholesterolemia. This is a 65-year-old male who has progressive decrease in the vision. So what do we see? This is a coronal T2-weighted image and axial T1-weighted image. We see there is severe atrophy of the optic chiasm as well as of the optic nerves. And what is the important thing what we see here is there is absence of flow void in both the cavernous ICA. Remember, ophthalmic artery is the only artery which is, it's the major artery which is supplying the optic nerve. And ophthalmic artery is a branch of ICA. So when there is thrombosis of ICA, obviously the ophthalmic artery is involved and this has resulted in optic neuropathy. So this is actually atherosclerotic thrombosis of both the ICA because of involvement of the ophthalmic artery resulting in optic atrophy. This I have shown the petrous segment of the petrous segment, which is showing complete absence of flow void. Thank you everyone. I hope you all have enjoyed this session on optic nerve imaging. Thank you so much.